Hello and welcome to the show. This is The Entrepreneur. My name is Paul K. Mwaura. Hope your 2015 is getting on well. Now, making payment of goods and services easier and accessible and online. Transfer of funds online, making them secure and risk-free. That is what our first guest tonight does. So join me as we learn more from him.
Hello, how are you?
Good,
thanks. I'm here to see Danson.
Okay. You had an appointment with him?
Yes, please.
Okay, can you hold on the line? Thank you. What's your name?
Paul from KTN, yeah.
Okay.
Hey, hello Danson.
How are you?
Fine, how are you doing?
Fine, thank you.
You good?
Karibu.
Asante sana.
Yes.
Nimekuja kukutembelea.
Ah, karibu sana.
Okay.
Yes.
Sasa, we can?
Maybe here we can tell when things are... My name is Danson Mushini. I'm the Chief Executive Officer at Jambo Pay.
Danson, so what services do you offer here at Jambo Pay?
Generally, giving solutions for cash handling. That's various processes, may it be when you're selling for e-commerce, when you have tickets that needs to be, events that needs ticketing solutions, when you have services that needs to be sold, and you have over-the-counter collections, and where you have disbursements, you are paying employees, you're paying wages that needs to be disbursed electronically.
And prior to this, you know, before you started Jambo Pay, what were you doing? Were you like employed before, you know, somewhere or what?
I was a student in the School of Life and also schools of KU. I also studied at Strathmore. So I worked briefly for a Turkish firm that was involved a bit in electronic payments.
Being a venture that Danson had always wanted to start, how much did he have as starting capital?
I estimate to be under 100,000 because we started off essentially in a cyber cafe. We cannot really say how much because we really had to source very many, do a lot of jobs, small tasks out there to put this together.
Okay.
So I estimate this to be under 100,000.
And what clientele do you, you know, do you target, you know, for the services that you offer here at Jambo Pay?
Today we target corporate clients. We have financial service providers such as insurance companies. We help a number of them in premium collections. We are seeking to get a lot more of this. We have outlets. These are shops. We have manufacturers and distributors who have high risks in cash handling. So to reduce that risk of cash handling, we target governments. We target more so now. We have a keen interest in county governments, their revenue collections. We also have a strong focus on e-commerce. That's enterprises that want to compete at electronic level away from the traditional brick and mortar.
Danson has a wide scope of work spread in the region. So how many employees has he gotten to help him with this task?
So we have over now 68 permanent. Sometimes we engage on casual. This is a number that get to over 110. Especially when we are doing activations. We have a presence in Kenya. We're also doing this in Tanzania and Senegal. We also have an office in the Netherlands.
Sometimes you know, challenges are inevitable. What kind of challenges are you facing here and how are you tackling them?
First challenge was there were no proper guidelines, laws. We had to work with the regulator, that is the central bank, specifically the National Payment Systems Division. They have now put in place. So initially, the first challenge was no proper framework or regulation for electronic payments. Number two had been the general perception of electronic payments in the market. There had been a fear for, and this still remains a challenge, albeit small or lower, of people trusting e-commerce, buying and selling over the internet. That has also been a major challenge. Another challenge has been resources. I put this number three, not number one, getting to deploy such kind of services and solutions usually would take quite some investments. You need investments in infrastructure, you need investments in networks and bandwidths, investment in personnel, and so forth.
I can see that your presence is felt, you know, regionally and across the borders. And you have so many employees that you have employed. What kind of qualifications do you look for when you're, you know, targeting these employees?
I think the first one is passion. We look at our team is highly passionate, well motivated. They understand what we do, so that's usually the first thing, and self-motivated. Secondly, is we also have a keen interest in ICT skills and more so software developments. We have a number of our team members also in hardware. We also are a business. We have also business. We have security people. That's applications and network security. We have strategy. So it is, I think, bottom line is highly motivated individuals and passionate. We have also an interest in qualifications, that's academic qualifications, what you've learned, skills acquired over years.
Having seen that, you know, most of the online payments, you know, have to do with the internet, are there times that probably the internet has failed you? And in those cases, what did you get to do?
We have now partnered with a number of internet service providers. We have what we call backups, links with the failovers, that if one goes, you have another one. So we currently work with about 5 internet service providers. So in case you have an issue of a broken link or a network failure on one, you can automatically switch to the next and so forth. This has, in the past, these are among the challenges that are faced by any technology firm.
He talks of his company's future plans to the entrepreneur.
Our future plans are to deepen financial services. We would like as many Africans as possible to have a Jamopay wallet, electronic wallet. We like as many enterprises as possible to accept Jamopay or electronic payments. We plan to grow into 7 African countries in the next 2 years. Now we are in Kenya, we are in Tanzania, we are in Senegal. We plan to grow around Central Africa and West more aggressively.
And what advice will Danson give to young entrepreneurs like him?
The time to start is now, not even tomorrow. And it starts by believing and getting yourself. You cannot be a boss out there if you are not a boss of your own self. Understand yourself, your strengths. Is there any training required? How strong are you? Do you need to undergo some training? Understand the environment, that is, what opportunities are there? What are the other players in that environment? What are the regulatory requirements for that kind of a business? And then you start somewhere, set processes, get a business card. Start selling.
As an entrepreneur, you can do services that make you get noticed in your area of expertise. Danson narrates his.
We have recently embarked on or been awarded the contract for the revenue collection for the city of Nairobi, county city of Nairobi. And this entails the automation of the various revenue streams for the county government of Nairobi. This includes the single business permits. We have the land rates payments. We have collections for their seasonal parkings, daily parkings. We also have other services such as single business permits, among others. Parking collection is one of the areas that you find has a mass or interact with the public. It is one of the first in Africa. It's actually one of the very first African city to automate its parking in such a manner. We have provided for Nairobi an integrated parking payment service that has a USSD. This USSD means the ability to do the revenue collection on mobile phone.
And how does he and his company give back to the community?
Just last the Saturday before Christmas, we were involved in a CSR activity in Lugulu. Lugulu is in Western, in a village. We went and interacted with the villagers in getting them to feel technology. Those young guys who aspire or who would want to know something, they want to become maybe techies or want to do something in technology, to get to experience and interact with guys in technology, information technology. Incidentally, we learned a lot. We got to understand a lot of needs that the society down the community out there have that can be met by ICT.
Danson, thank you very much. So when do you want the game of chess?
Anytime.
Even after this?
Yeah, even
this. Okay. So there you have it from Danson. You know, you must be good at something. And if you know what you're good at, keep at it and let it see you to levels of success. We are going on a short commercial break, but before we do that, we have some wisdom nuggets for you. So just hold on and listen to them.
Wealth and success are a state of mind. Keep your mind fit by always working. Dr. Manu Chandaria, Industrialist.
In the meantime, engage us on our social media pages that are on your screen right now, Facebook and Twitter. Keep the conversation going. After this, we have another guest for you, so please do not go away. Keep it locked to KTN. See you shortly. Welcome back to the show. If you're joining us, we're in the second segment of The Entrepreneur. Now, our second guest, you probably may have seen him in a hair advert some time back. Now, he's into trichology and his theme is restoring confidence. He's doing it as a business. So join me as we talk to him and learn more tonight. Hey, Mr. Muli.
Hey. How are you?
Good. How are you?
Yeah, good.
Thank you.
All right. My name is Muli Musyoka. I'm a trichologist, so I run hair restoration clinic. It's the only one of its kind in the region.
Who exactly is a trichologist?
A trichologist is someone who helps to diagnose and treat hair and scalp problems. Some of the conditions, a trichologist in Kenya is not allowed to perform medical procedures, and I'm not a medical doctor. So I work very closely with medical doctors and surgeons in that manner.
Before you started this, were you involved in any other ventures or what were you doing before?
I've done a lot of things, Paul. I've been a mitumba guy. I've sold mitumbas a lot. Mm-hmm. Immediately before I got into hairdressing, I used to act at the Kenya National Theatre. Way before, back in 2006, in 2004, I was a garbage collector in Machakos. And I've done quite a number of things. I've been a volunteer in Red Cross for many, many years, since I was in high school.
So how long did Muli take in harboring this idea?
It took me 2 years to train in trichology and finish. But as soon as I started training, I realized this was a business opportunity for me to really start a clinic that people would come, consult, get solutions, even if I'm not the person giving solutions. So it's an idea that has been building. Every day when I do things, I realize other things.
Muli tells the entrepreneur when his venture took off its feet.
I'd say this venture is actually just starting, but the idea has been there. When I came back from Australia in 2010, December, I started very small time consultations. I mean, I would hawk consultation services from office to the other office. I remember I would go and see people in offices. And then a friend of mine gave me office space for Saturdays only for 3 hours. And I would pack all consultations then. I didn't have many of them because, of course, this is a very new concept and people had not heard about it. But I mean, when we started working on people, when I started consulting with people, I started getting results and the people started sending people to me. So I've felt so strongly about getting permanent solutions like hair transplant, which we're doing. And I got my partner, who is a surgeon, I started speaking to him really to go to to train on hair transplant. I had worked in a hair transplant clinic in Australia for voluntary services, but they would give me something small. And my idea was not really to earn money, but to learn. And I've learned that when you're young, you work to learn. And a time will come when you will work to earn.
And how much capital did you, you know, get to inject, you know, when you're starting this venture that you have?
We've actually spent up to around 6 million just to really start up the whole idea. How we got the 6 million, I'll not lie to you that I went to banks, because you go to banks and they tell you, get me someone who has 6 million, they deposit the money in a fixed account and I give you 6 million. And I think that is what has really discouraged a lot of young entrepreneurs.
And who do you target? Who do you target for these procedures?
We target the high-end consumer, someone who can... Some of our procedures actually cost 400,000, 500,000. And we have people in Kenya doing them. When you look at most of the services that we offer, they are not services that the mass market would afford as yet. But as we expand and as we grow, we will definitely find a way of being able to reach and help everybody who requires our services. Because our driving force is not the money and the profits that we make, but really being able to see that we're impacting the lives of people.
Your venture being like, you know, the first in the region, what kind of challenges are you facing and how are you handling them?
The first thing was believability. I mean, people believing that, people will always say, it's unfortunate that we are born in a very negative world. So people don't believe that things that they've not seen before can actually happen. People live out of memory, and people who live out of imaginations are the ones succeeding. Because when I came back, people said, people have gone to the moon, why haven't they ever planted their hair? You know. And until now, we started getting patients who actually accepted for us to do trials on them, and then they saw the results. That's when slowly people started believing that actually what I'm talking about is something that is doable.
Taking your name out there may need strategy and wisdom. As for Muli, he knew what medium to use and why.
Let me tell you one thing, and I think every other young entrepreneur must learn this. Media is very good, but media is very expensive. They must learn how to use free media. When Facebook was free, I took advantage of it. And today people look for us through Facebook.
Trichology, you know, you said it's the first in the region. And how has been the reception here in Kenya? Have people like gotten to receive it, you know, and be able to actually come to the clinic and do this transplant?
I think seeing is believing. We've not been actively advertising on radio, TV, billboards or magazines. But when some patients came, they got solutions and they saw their hair back, that has been our platform.
What advice would you give to people who think they have a first-time idea, yet they want to grow into success?
Let me tell you, first ideas are fantastic, as long as you believe in them. And before you go out to sell an idea, you must sell it to yourself until it becomes commercially viable, and then you sell it to someone else. Because who you are buying the words, you know, anyone can come and have an invention which can never become an innovation, because an innovation is a new idea that will actually make money for you. Or if someone has to fund the idea, then they will ask, what is it in there for me? What is the return on investment? So if you have an idea that you feel is the first, actually that's a very good thing, because you have a weapon that nobody else has.
Muli has traversed different fields of trade and entrepreneurship. Thus, he is able to give advice to upcoming entrepreneurs.
Number one is knowledge. Knowledge is a new currency. The field you are in, you really must be the best. When people are out there partying, you should be out there researching on your industry. Then number two, it'll never be easy. So you have to look for people who have done it before. We are very connected. I'm a member of the International Association of Trichologists. There are cases that I see that I've never seen before, but other people have seen before. So I share on that platform and they advise me. Or someone somewhere will actually say, I've seen this case and this is how we worked on it.
What are his future plans for his business?
Definitely expansion. But before we think about expansion is... At the moment, what the business is doing is really to train, coach and get people with the right training. Of course, we've recruited people who are medically certified in the country. But at the same time, we need more people in trichology, people who can actually identify or give the correct diagnosis, because before you formulate the treatment or the therapy, you must get it right. And sometimes it calls for us sending biopsies to pathologists for analysis, and then we can get exactly what is the cause of the hair loss. So if you do not get the right people doing the correct trichological job, then they could kill the business. So we're getting people trained, and the reason why we're training people is because we need to expand. Definitely in the next 5 years, we will be talking about clinics across, East Africa. We're seriously looking at South Africa and other parts of Africa.
Basically, real estate is more of a passion to me, and it really excites me. For one, creation. You can just see empty land like that. People, you put a team together to make a drawing, to make calculations, QAs, and all the professionals, engineers, and within a minute, that can be something out of nothing, out of soil.
If you have any comments on tonight's Entrepreneur, leave a comment on our Facebook page, KTN The Entrepreneur, or reach us on our Twitter handle, KTN The Entrepreneur.